But before we talk about the pushing phase, let's talk about how the baby descends through the pelvis. Because we don't just do effacement and dilation, although that's a big part of it. The other part that has to happen is that the baby has to move down and out through the pelvis. So back to our pelvis, this is the pelvic inlet at the top, and this is the pelvic outlet at the bottom where the baby comes out. There's also two points I want to point out. Kind of hard to see, but right here and right here, these are little bumpy points called the ischial spines. The baby is said to be engaged in the pelvis when the largest part of the head begins to enter the pelvic inlet. And as the baby's coming down to the pelvis, while it's up here, it's considered to be what we call negative station. So we get -3, -2, -1. And when the head reaches those bumpy points called the ischial spines, that's considered to be zero station. And as it comes out and descends further, it would be at +1, station +2, and station +3. And when you get to about station +3, this is considered crowning. And that's because as the baby's head is coming out, you can see the crown of their head. So now let's talk about the baby's position as it's being born. As the baby is coming down through the pelvis, the best position for the baby to be in is with their back to the birthing person's left side, they're facing the birthing person's right side, and their chin is tucked. This is the easiest way for the baby to be born, and it's called left occiput anterior position. On the other hand, when babies are born this way, with their back against their parent's back, this is called posterior position. It's also called sunny side up because when the baby comes out, their face is looking right up at you. So sunny side up or posterior makes for a longer, more complicated, more difficult birth, and you're more likely to have a cesarean or C-section with a posterior position baby. So you can see how the baby's head just fits better this direction as opposed to this direction. When a baby is posterior, that actually increases the diameter of their head. So I have a measuring tape here, and you can see if the baby's head is presenting posterior and we measure it, that's actually quite a bit larger or wider than a baby's head that's coming out like this. So this is why it's important to understand what position your baby is in as it's coming out. However, babies can shift and move during the labor process. So just because they start off in a posterior position doesn't mean they're going to stay in a posterior position, but it does mean that you need to take notice of the baby's position and work to make more room in your pelvis for the baby to have more room to get into a better position for the birth or a more ideal position for the birth. Now, babies are more likely to be in that posterior position with their back against the birthing person's back if the person who's giving birth has been immobilized, such as with an epidural, and they're lying flat on their back with an epidural. This is why upright positions in movement or shifting positions during the birth is very important to help make room and help encourage the baby to get into that left occiput anterior position. This is also why it's important, if you have an epidural, that your support team help you shift positions, hopefully with the help of a peanut ball, which is a prop that can be used to open up your pelvis. So let's say this baby is coming out in the ideal path with their back to the birthing person's left side. They're facing the right, their chin is tucked, and the smallest diameter of the head is entering the pelvis. Now you're fully dilated, you're 10 centimeters dilated, and you're ready to start pushing. Now some people, if you have an epidural, you may choose to do something called delayed pushing or passive descent while you wait for an urge to push. But most people, when they get to this point of being 10 centimeters dilated, they've reached what we call stage 2, and they're ready to start pushing. The pushing phase, or stage 2, can be as short as 1 minute in someone who's given birth before, and it can be normal to take as long as 2, 3, 4, or even 5 hours in a first-time birthing person with an epidural. Stage two starts with the 10 centimeter dilation and ends with the birth of the baby. The contractions space out a little bit here, so you get some more time in between contractions. So you get a little bit of a break. And a lot of people say that it feels really good to push, that it's a rewarding part of labor. So the person who's giving birth will be pushing with the contractions, then resting in between. And as they're pushing, both the birthing person and the baby will be working towards this birth. So as the baby is being born, it's going to go through the cardinal movements of labor. These are actually some reflexes that the baby undertakes to get out and be born. So as the baby's coming out, it'll be pushing up against its mother to help make room and wiggle its way out. And as the head crowns and begins to come out, the head will first turn to face its mother's back. And then after the head is out, the head will turn to align itself with the shoulders. And then one shoulder will pop out and the other. And then once the shoulders are out, the rest of the baby slips out fairly easily and goes straight to the parent's chest. So now we have reached stage three, and we're also in the golden hour, and these two stages overlap a little bit. So during stage three, that starts after the baby's born, and it ends with the birth of the placenta. Now, while the baby's cord is still attached, about one third of the baby's own blood supply is still left behind in the placenta. And the placenta at this point is still inside you. So it's very important to let the remainder of the baby's blood flow through that umbilical cord to the baby. It takes anywhere from 3 to 5 minutes for that to occur, sometimes even longer. The best way to know that the baby's gotten all the blood is that the cord has stopped pulsing and the cord turns white. Now, in some places, they immediately clamp the cord after the birth to prevent the baby's blood from going into the baby. This is an outdated practice, and research shows that it's very important to leave the cord unclamped for at least 3 to 5 minutes, but preferably until the cord turns white. And this allows the baby to get all the blood that they had in their placenta. Stage three, while you're waiting for the birth of placenta, takes anywhere from 5 to 30 minutes, and you do have to give birth to the placenta, but the placenta is easier to birth than a baby because it doesn't have any bones. One thing we haven't talked about yet is the perineum and the birthing person's vagina. So I've put a cloth over the bottom of the pelvis to help simulate that. And you can see here that this tissue between the vaginal opening is here, and here's the rectum. This tissue here is called the perineum. And thankfully, all of this area is stretchy. It can stretch to allow the birth of your baby's head and shoulders. Now, doctors used to think that they had to cut a woman with scissors right about here in order to make room for the baby's head. But we know now that that kind of cut, called an episiotomy, causes more harm than good. It's more painful than any natural tears that might occur, and it's more likely to extend to a severe tear called a type 3 or 4 perineal tear. So just like you might see with the piece of fabric, it's hard to just simply rip open the fabric. But if you make a cut with scissors in fabric, it's much easier to extend the tear. And so this is why rates of episiotomies have gone down. They are still high in some parts of the world and with some providers, but thankfully the rates of episiotomies have been going down. Some doctors, unfortunately, still practice the way they were trained decades ago, and the belief back then was that every mother should have an episiotomy. But now research shows that not only are episiotomies more painful, but they cause more severe tears. They don't heal as well or as quickly as a natural tear would. So we'll talk more about protecting your perineum and preventing tears in other videos. So I hope you enjoyed this video all about the stages of labor, and thank you for watching. Say bye.